Okay, so in our last few classes, we have seen how to design flexural reinforcement and seen how to design shear reinforcement. Today, what I'll be doing is I'll be showing you a RCC structural detailing drawing where you can find the reinforcement details of beams, slab, columns, footing, etc. But by now you are aware of reinforcement provision in the beam, I would like to show how exactly it is being provided. To start with, here you can see we have a key plan, and this key plan is for the upcoming water treatment plant. Okay, so for the upcoming water treatment plant, so you have reservoir, you have pump house, you have sedimentation tank, you have flocculation tank, so all those units are there in this water treatment plant. One of the unit is chemical house. So maybe this here is your chemical house. And let us step by step study this drawing. So before getting into the reinforcement detail or the structural detail, I'll read these notes. So here, as you can see here, it's been mentioned. So whenever you are going to prepare a structural drawing, okay, for any RCC structure, in the same manner, you have to specify what is the clear cover which has to be followed, because this is the drawing which is going to be supplied at the site, and the engineer there, he has to execute the structure based on the drawing which has been provided to him or her. So before placing the reinforcement, I need to know what should be my clear cover. So here you can see for slab, which is one of the RCC element, you need to provide 15 mm cover at the top and bottom. And for lintel and beam, what is the cover which you have to provide? You have to provide 25 mm all round. It means top, bottom and side, this cover has to be maintained. And for end of slab, beam and lintel, again, it is done 25 mm minimum or twice dia of bar, whichever is more for end of the slab. For column, it has specified 40 mm, and for column footing, the clear cover has to be 50 mm. Because maybe based on this data, the designer might have designed the structure. So that is why this data has to be given. Apart from this, they specify what should be the grade of the concrete. Okay, so the grade of the concrete, here it is written for water retaining structure. Like reservoir, you are going to use M30 grade concrete. For non-water retaining structure, like chemical house, so you are going to use M25 grade concrete. Also, it's been specified what should be the length of these plies. So what is splice? So you know, the reinforcing bar which you are going to get is going to be of limited length. Say if you are making a column of say 30 meter height, so you are not going to get a reinforcing bar length of 30 meter length. So what you will be doing at some suitable location, you need to join these two bars. So these two bars can be joined by providing splices, or you can use mechanical couplers. But for a normal construction work, you don't go for mechanical couplers. Rather than what you do, you splice these bars. Here, actually, they should have given what should be the grade of the reinforcement. So the grade of reinforcement, so I know here for this particular chemical house, or for this RCC structure, the grade of reinforcement has to be Fe500 steel. You can see the foundation plan of chemical house. Maybe some architectural drawing might have been given to the structural engineer, and he must have proposed based on the architectural drawing. He must have proposed what should be the footing. So you can see you have isolated footing. Okay, so isolated footing mean individual support has been provided to individual columns, and each of these columns has been marked like C1, C2, C3. So whatever marking has been given, so those are the marking for the column. Now you are tying these beams, and these beams has been marked as FB1 and FB2. So you can think of these beams. Actually, they should have given TB1 and TB2. In fact, tie beam 1, tie beam 2. Okay, so anyway, so they have given, they are tying the beam at the plinth level, and they have denoted that these beams as FB1. So you can read this as floor beam 1. So FB. So floor beam 1. So it basically means at plinth level, they have tied these column using these floor beams. Like suppose if I want to know what is the reinforcement detail over here for this beam. So I know the marking is FB1. So I'll see FB1 and same reinforcement detail, whatever this beam is having, same has to be given for this one and for this beam also. So I don't need to make three different reinforcement detail. So one reinforcement detail for FB1 is going to suffice for all these three beams. Similarly, one reinforcement detail for FB2 is going to suffice for this beam and this beam. Now further, the first floor plan has been specified. So in the first floor plan, so the slab is going to be there. That slab is going to be again supported by the beams. So here also you can see those beams are also again marked FB1 and FB2. And all these beam is having a saved dimension, like FB1 is 250 by 300. Here also FB1 is 250 by 300. So total number of FB1 beam, if you see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Six number of FB1 beams are there and six number of FB2 beam is there. So if I give one reinforcement detail for FB1, so basically it is valid for all six beams, which has been marked FB1. And if I give the reinforcement detail for FB2, so that is also valid for all six beams of FB2 at the plinth level and at the first floor level. Further, at the top floor, you have roof beam. So you can see RB. So again, it's a nomenclature they have used, RB1 and RB2. So you have three numbers of RB1 beam and three numbers of RB2 beam. Since now you are very much aware of designing beams, and when I say designing beams, you need to know the cross-section dimension, you need to know what is the flexural reinforcement, what is the shear reinforcement, though we have not yet done the check for deflection, which we'll be doing, and also a check for the development length. So that is also we'll be discussing in the coming classes. So we'll be discussing those topics, but before that, let us see any one of the beam, say FB2. So I would like to see what is the reinforcement detail of FB2 beam. So let us see. Okay, here you can see detail of floor beam marked FB2. So how to read this drawing? So you can see in this beam, you can see some lines. Okay, these lines you can see. Let me take this screenshot and explain. Okay, so let us try to understand this reinforcement detail. You can see some lines. So you have bottom reinforcement and top reinforcement, as well as strip is also being provided. So how to identify this? So you see this line, this green which I'm marking, this one. Okay, this one. So what is this bar? This is 216 tor. So you're using 216 tor. And what is this ALTH? All through. All through means this is one single bar which you're providing all through. Okay. So you have this bar marked as B1. So if I write bar marking, this is going to be helpful for drawing the bar bending schedule. I assume that you are studying this course, estimation and costing. So maybe you'll be introduced to this bar bending schedule. Now, when I write bar marking, so I have bar marking B1. Okay, and what is the shape of? So you have this bar marking B1. What is the shape of this bar? The shape of this bar is like this. And how many numbers are required? Okay, so you can make like this, because this will help you in the bar bending schedule and for cutting the bar, bar marking. So I am having bar marking B1. And then I'll write here shape of the bar, how exactly it looks like. Okay. And then I can write what is the number of bars. And once I know the number of bars, I can specify what is the diameter of the bar. And further, you can compute what is the quantity in kg also you can write, or in ton if you want, you can. So right now this bar is marked B1. Okay, this bar is marked B1. So I have written B1. I can write this shape. Now in this shape, from the geometry, okay, from the geometry, I'd be able to know what is this length of the bar. So this length of the bar you can specify. Say this is L1 And this band also you can specify what is L2. So if you know L1 and L2, you'll be knowing what is the length of each bar, number of bars. So you know, this is FB2. Now FB2 beam, how many beams have to be provided? So 3 beams in the ground floor, 3 beams in the floor level. So 6. So 6 into 2. So there are 12 number of bars. Okay, 12 number of bar is there. And what is the dia? It is 16 dia. So rather than quantity, let me write the length of the bar. Length of the bar. So what will be the length of the bar? So you can give what? 12 into L1 plus L2. 12 into L1 plus twice of L2, because you have two bands. So you get the total length. So can you compute the volume? If you know the volume, you multiply with the density of steel, you'll get the weight in kgs. So you can compute what is the mass of the bar which is required in kgs. So that you can easily do. Okay, so this is this kind of table you make in order to know the quantity of reinforcement required. And you'd be knowing, like if you have 12 dia bar, how much quantity of bar you need to buy. So if you make this kind of schedule for your like RCC element. So anyway, here you can see this is 216 and this bar is marked B1. Okay, now what about the top reinforcement? In the top reinforcement, if you observe, you have this bar, you can see this red line, this one, and try to see this. So you have 212 tor all through. So this bar has been marked T1. Okay, so you have 212 dia bar, which is all through this length. Okay, and apart from this, you have extra top bar. If you observe here, you please observe here, you are providing extra top bar. And how much extra top bar you are providing? You see 116. Okay, so you are providing actually 116 extra top bar. So at this region you have bar mark T1, that is 212, and this one extra 16 bar which has been provided, this bar has been marked T2. So here you are having 212 and 116 dia bar. I would like to know the stirrups. So if you see stirrups, here is the stirrups. This one. You see this stirrup. This is the stirrup line, and this is also the stirrup line. The sketch is not good, but try to understand this one. This is my stirrup. Now from here to here, they have marked with this arrow. From this distance till this distance, you are going to provide 8 tor at 200 center to center stirrups all through. They have not specified a number of legs, but you'd get the number of legs from the section which has been cut. So you have to go provide stirrups of 8 dia at 200 center to center from here till here. Similarly, the other side also you can see stirrups, other side of the beam, this one and this one. So you can see here also you have this stirrups. OK, though they have forgotten to mark here. OK, they have forgotten to mark here, but here you have to write 8 tor at 200 center to center. And this stirrup has been marked as S1. Now let us see section 5.5. Now in section 5.5, I know here you have 212, that is T1 bar. And here you have which bar? B1 bar. So you can see in section 5. You see T1 bar and B1 bar. In the bottom you have B1 and in the top you have T1. T stands for top, B stands for bottom. So B1 I know it is 216. T1 is 212, I know it. And what about stirrups? Stirrup is S1, which is 8 tor at 200 center to center. But when I come to section 6.6, so section 6.6 is over here where you have provided extra top bars. So extra top bars, so I'll see here, you can see in the edges you have T1 bar, and in between you have T2 bar. So you know T2 is 16 dia bar. And same thing, S1 you know, and you know what is B1. So this is how actually you should also make your enforcement detail. And yesterday, what we tried to do, if you recall, we made a rough sketch. Yeah, here this. This was the rough sketch which we had made for a simply supported beam. Okay, so this was a rough sketch, and you can see I made two sections in order to show the stirrups distribution as well as your longitudinal reinforcement detail. So in similar manner, this reinforcement detail has been shown. Now, can you tell me why extra top bar has been provided at the top? Can anyone tell me why extra top bar has been provided here near the intermediate support? Because you can see this is one of the column, this is one of the column, this is one of the column. Can you tell me why?
So, वहाँ पे hogging moment आएगा इसलिए.
Hogging moment आएगा. Yes, very much right. Like as you can see, this is a continuous beam. A continuous beam is having what? More than two supports. So you have three supports. So you can imagine your beam like this. This is the beam. Here is your support. Here is your support. Here is your support. And say if I apply a UDL like this, and if I ask you to plot the bending moment diagram for this beam. So you might be studying analysis of indeterminate structure. So using slope deflection method, a moment distribution method, or Carney's method, you can find the moments at the intermediate support, or how it is varying along the beam. So what you do, you make first free bending moment diagram like this. I'm going to assume that you are knowing this. Now, since this is simply supported, moment is going to be zero here, moment is going to be zero. Here you will be having a negative moment and you are going to join this. So finally, the resultant moment diagram is going to be this area. So this is going to be positive. Okay, the sign of this moment is going to be what? Positive. And this is also going to be positive. And here you will be having negative. So as you can see that there is a portion near this intermediate support, you have hogging moment. Hogging moment means tension at the top. Okay, sagging moment means like positive, whatever you are saying, it means tension is at the bottom. So wherever you are getting sagging moment, you have the, those bottom reinforcement as your main reinforcement. But where you are having hogging moment, the top fiber will be in tension, so the reinforcement at the top is going to be your main reinforcement. And as you can see that here, this particular point, this point here, what is happening? So if I observe this particular point here, moment is becoming zero. So basically you don't need additional reinforcement at the top. So that is why what is happening, they are not providing this 116 all through. They are curtailing the bar actually. Okay, and we'll be talking about where exactly you should curtail your bar when we discuss our next topic, that is bond and development length. So I should ascertain whether this length, how I should ascertain what should be this length, what should be this length. And immediate question would be coming to you, what will be this length? What should be this length? So these lengths are called as development length. So from here till here, whatever bend you are providing. Okay, these are called the development length. Is this detail clear to everyone? Like whatever we discussed. So just I wanted to show with reference to a structural drawing, whatever we studied is actually same thing. Only this thing is what problem is different. Here the problem is what you have a continuous beam. In this continuous beam, if you know what is this ultimate load, you draw this bending moment diagram. From this bending moment diagram, identify what is your maximum moment. For this maximum moment, design your longitudinal steel. Similarly, at support, you compute what is the moment. Now, based upon that moment, you compute what is the steel which is going to be required at the support. Similarly, you draw the shear force diagram for this beam. Try to know what is the maximum shear. For that shear, you design your shear reinforcement. So this is what you are going to do for this beam also. And the same thing has been done. I just shown you one part. me show the other part also. So that when you get any opportunity to read any drawing, so you can split that. So I had shown you one of the part FB2. Similarly, you can see FB1. See FB1. So reinforcement detail has been marked. Section has been cut. Okay, section 2-2, section 3-3. So you can always go here. Section 2-2, section 3-3. And these bars has also been marked. T1, that is top one. And you can see there is one beam, detail of lintel beam. So there is some kind of DET. You need to read it as detail of lintel beam marked LB1. Okay, so this is the detail of the lintel beam, which will be provided where there is going to be opening for the door and windows, that you're going to provide this lintel beam. So this is a beam. Apart from beam, you know, you're going to have staircase. So the detail of the staircase is also being specified. Okay, then you have a number of columns which has been marked C1 to C9. So this is the isolated footing detail which has been given. Okay, and if you observe this thing, -1.20. So what do you mean by -1.20? So from ground level, so say ground level is zero level. So the depth of the foundation is going to be -1.20, meaning that is 1.20 plus 0.25 plus 0.075. So this 75 mm thick, some plain cement concrete work they are doing. Okay, they are providing a PCC. Over the PCC, they are laying this footing. So we'll be learning about this footing design. And whatever you are seeing over here, this particular part, this part is called as pedestal. Okay, they provide this pedestal. The advantage of providing this pedestal is to reduce the bearing stress and to reduce the thickness of this particular footing. So that kind of advantage they are trying to take. Okay, because if they can reduce the thickness of the footing, it means they are saving concrete. And also one more advantage you'll get, you will not going to get very large diameter bar or very large bar in your footing. So here the footing is having reinforcement detail as 12 dia, which is placed at 120 mm center to center. And here there is a nomenclature BW. It means both ways. Both ways means the reinforcement has to be given in both directions, in along length and along width also. Along both direction, you have to give 12 tor at 120 mm center to center. And here this nomenclature BOT, it means bottom. Okay, it is means what? Bottom. Now here you can see the reinforcement detail for the roof slab. And in the roof slab, since as you can see, this is the slab part, and whatever this line you see, these are my beams, right? These are my beams. So as you're going to do the monolithic construction, that's why they have made this kind of sketch. Again, the reinforcement detail here, it has been shown. 8 dia, that is 8 tor of steel, that is HYSD bar only. At 200 center to center, both ways. Okay, and they are marking this as what? B1 and B2. Similarly, near support, this is also 8 tor, not at 200 center to center, but it is at 250 millimeter center to center. So this is for roof. Further, if you want to see the reinforcement detail, okay, for the slabs, like I would like to know what is the reinforcement detail here. And one more thing, you can see something called 4.2. So these are levels. So as I was talking about here, -1.2. This is the level at the top of the footing. Okay, when here it is written 4.2, it means level at the top of the first floor. And when I come to this thing, roof portion, the top of the roof portion should be 8 meter. So you get an idea. You can subtract 8 minus 4.2 and the thickness of the slab, you'll get clear ceiling height at the first floor room. So you can see section 4A has been cut. and it is cutting through the slab and the staircase. So you'll be able to see the reinforcement detail of at least the slab which is going to be provided. So let us see section 4A. Yeah, you can see here section 4A. So detail of first floor slab reinforcement detail. So here also you can see this is the slab. Now this slab is getting intermediate support. So that is why you're going to get hogging movement at support. So you have extra reinforcement which isn't provided at the top. But at the span portion, you don't need to provide. Okay, so since you do not provide shear reinforcement in this slab, and we'll be talking about why don't we provide shear reinforcement in this slab when we will be discussing the design of slab. Okay, but I can tell you the shear resistance offered by the concrete in this slab is very high. That is why you don't need a shear reinforcement basically. Okay, so from here also you get an idea of what is the reinforcement detail of the slab. So again here section 4-4, so they have cut section 4-4. So this is also giving you detail of first floor slab also. And at roof also it is given. Okay, anything you would like to ask from this structural detail drawing? So this drawing was quite simple in fact, but it was nice drawing to start with because it is not very complicated. And I assume if you go through this drawing, you'd be able to understand it and you'd be able to instruct anyone that how the reinforcement has to be placed for a particular structural element.